Mazda 929 Coupe. This is already the facelifted version. The early versions have some sort of an opera window right here that makes it look very, very cool. 929 GLX, some Subaru Imprezas right here, all the way from the UK. Lovely, lovely A82 Corolla GT. That one looks stunning, to be honest. Also a car that sort of vanished from the streets in all possible African countries because of many reasons. Lovely looking 626, is it a four-wheel steering car? Is it? It's not. Toyota Crown Royal Saloon, is it a S120? I'm not sure if it is. Let's see what it says. It's a GS121. Among my favorite crowns, or the JDM spec. This is for navigating through the dense Japanese traffic. The rain guards, of course. It's a pillarless look. It's not pillarless, but frameless windows. And it's one of the crowns we never got in Europe. Celica beefed up MR2. Just have a look at this. Chinook Newport camper van based on the Toyota. What was the name again of it? I can't tell you right now, but it looks cool. Looks cool. Definitely imported from the UK, not from the UK, from the United States. Just look at the roof antenna. Well, all the amazing stuff to see at the Japan Classic Sunday here in Gemert. Toyota Starlet Estate. Then we have a Toyota Crown Estate. One of the last generations of the Crown to be sold in Germany, at least. And one of my favorite early Toyota estate details are the double wiper action here at the back. It's a 2.8 V6, inline six. Is it a six? You know better. There we have the Chinook again. Toyota Sports 800. Incredibly rare. Small engine Japanese sports car from the early days. Was it earlier as the iconic 2000? I believe it was. Okay, let's have a look at this Celica all the way from Germany. And it is a Celica T-top. Not a T-top, it's a Targa. A Celica Targa. And honestly, I've never heard of a Celica Targa. But as I love Targa roofs, I think the Targa is the perfect style of a car. Yeah, as said, it's the first time US spec, hence the bright yellow indicators. And I think these are driving lights right there. Cool looking car. The vinyl roof, by the way, looks a bit out of place on the sporty Celica. But all in all, it's cool. There we have a earlier Carina. And these are, I think these are the wheels from a Supra. MR2s. And the dirty Corolla is leaving the show with a very happy owner. There's a Starlet. It says Starlet Turbo. Celica convertible leaving the show. And I'm about to show you an another show's favorite, and that is, well, let's go this way and approach the car from the back. Okay, behold, because it's a Datsun 260 Z Coupe, a pillarless Cedric Coupe, I guess, if you will. Absolutely one of a kind. Check out this interior. It can't be any better. Brown vinyl roof with a sunroof. Let's try to, well, there's the Cedric badge. Let's try to get a better look. And you know, it is not that easy because cars are coming and going, but there you have it. It's a fantastic looking car from the more or less baroque period of Japanese car design. You know, pillarless coupes are beside the Targa. It's first the Targa, followed by the pillarless roof. So these are my favorites, now you know. Now, by the way, I had a chat with the owner about the 260Z, so he got this car in 87. It got a full restoration, but it just looks like it was when he got the car. But well, done and painted. The vinyl roof was actually brown, like it is today. Okay, some more Nissan Bluebirds. And this is the one that was produced in the UK. Some years ago, 2 years ago maybe, there was one of the early production prototypes here at the show. And that was pretty amazing. As you can see, lots of stuff is going on here. And I think I need a break now, because it's way too much to see here. Brilliant stuff such as this Nissan. Well, is it a Urvan? Is it your van? Oh, I don't know. There we have a, is it a Supra? I guess it's a Supra. It's a Japanese sports cars. It's a Celica, but wasn't there a beefed up version? There was the Celica Supra. I'm not sure. Love the look of the headlights here. These are pop-up headlights. And this newer type Celica is parked just beside its grandpa, the early Celica. It's a Celica GT on Wolf Races. These fit perfectly to the car. You know, the early shape of Celica is my favorite, because pillarless, but I think pillarless is the word you can't hear anymore. And there is the second POW of the show. And as far as I know, Jupp told me that this has got a larger engine. Not sure. As said, I think it's a 1.3, but as many POWs, it has some rust issues. It was one of the problems of many Japanese cars of that era. It's on steelies, not on the usual sweet painted POW wheels. Honda Beat's leaving the show. Honda Beat is one of the key roadster trio I've mentioned before, with the engine at the rear. Back to the POW. Canvas top. This has the darker, is it a green? Is it a blue? It's a green. I'm undecided. There we have the POW badge produced at the Pike factory. What a great looking car. And it's just beside a 240Z. A newer I think it's a 300 ZX. Looks a bit like a US spec. A white car, Targa T-top. Red leather interior. That looks the part. I do love the look of these later 300 ZXs. Now the Celica, that looks a bit like a Mustang. So this is a, well, ST 2000. Looks very, very like a Mustang. Was it a Mustang Mach-3? Not sure. So many, many design clues from that car. So this is the, well, when we look at all the Celicas, in my eyes, this is the muscle car Celica. Some S2000s, revving as high as possible. Is it a Celsior? I'm not sure. Well, JDM, of course, never got here. There we have a Toyota Corona. It's a Corona Mark II, and I think the Mark II was followed by the Cressida. Could be wrong here. Very, very green rotary powered RX-7 beside a white RX-7, another Celica muscle car. There's going some music in the MX-5. There we have the Kujiras again. Well, and now I'm off for a little break. So what we just found, Buzz and me, we just found, well, a Seat Malaga. And it's not only a Malaga, it's a GLX 1.5. It's missing its horn button, but it has a real spoiler, it has plastic hubcaps, and it's absolutely excellent. It has some speed holes. This makes almost every car faster, lighter, better. This is absolutely brilliant. I haven't seen a Malaga in ages. There's more excellent stuff, such as this Renault 25 V6, LPG converted. And in my eyes, and I said that when I've seen the 25 at the Eindhoven Museum yesterday. It's one of Robert Opron's best works. I wonder if this is a real Baccarat. So Reynolds' version of a posh car was named the Baccarat. But there's more amazing stuff. Buzz is a big fan of this Ford Fusion. Original good old Heimer mobile. Toyota Starlet. You have so many of those. There are plenty of them roaming around in the Netherlands. Oh yes! Oh, the Lada is about to leave. So I don't want to distract the owners from their plants. This is Buzz's Peugeot. It's a 505 GR, is it?
Yes.
Engine?
2.0.
It has a sunroof and these super comfy cloth seats. Alloys. There it is from the back. It has, of course, a tow hook, because Dutch car. Then we have a interesting looking Ford Fiesta with quite a lot of stickers. But the interesting thing is parked here. It's a lowered, very mean looking Peugeot 205. I wonder why it has no grill. Because of the looks. Maybe. Ah. The Alpha Sud. This is a great looking thing. Just check out the whole color of this very early example. And the hubcaps look amazing. I never realized that there's an Alfa Romeo written in it. That looks great. Also, there's a Alfa Romeo logo there at the mirror. No headrests, red vinyl interior. I've seen this steering wheel before today. And if you've watched that video until now, you know where. Give you a little hint. It was a Nissan. Let's go over there, because there we have a Kia Pride, first generation Kia Pride, based on the Mazda 121 DA, I guess, or the Ford Festiva, or many, many other cars. It's still produced in Iran by, I guess, Saipa, is it? Anyway, there's the Pride badge. In Germany, these were sold as a three-door, five-door, and five-door estate. Speaking of Germany, there's an exciting car from Germany, which is this good old Mercedes 170S in a rather ratty look. Look what happened to the star. That is very, very nicely done. It says, fuck off, but please. And it also said, it will never get a new paint. And that's all right, because it just looks good as it is. And here we are at another JDM car. Which is a Nissan Sima V8. It's on German plates. Never sold in Germany. Right-hand drive car, because, well, JDM. And it was one of the crown competitors. As always, I love these special badges. Japanese cars have. By the way, I'm a big fan of rain guards. I'm one of the few really liking this feature. Another Nissan, so very rare one, even rare back in the day, is the Nissan Prairie with a sliding door. The first Prairie, the Prairie Pro. I haven't seen one in ages, but that goes for this later one as well. Let's have another look at the Life Step Van now with a closed bonnet. Pretty sure it is the rarest car, rarest of the rare. I bet it's maybe the only one in Europe. So we've seen this before, but now with closed bonnet, it's worth a second look. So the ABC cars, if you remember minutes ago, one of the ABC cars, the K Sports Roadsters, was the Honda Beat. A again, AutoZam AZ1, B was the Beat, C was the Cappuccino, and well, the Copen came a while later. This is A. S660, just have a look at this funky interior. So this is the rear-engined K Roadster Honda Beat. Unfortunately, never sold here. By the way, the Suzuki Cappuccino was sold in Europe in very small numbers, officially by Suzuki, but the Beat unfortunately never made it to Europe. The Honda 600 made it to Europe. This is on German plates. It was one of the first Honda cars to be sold in Germany. It's also a K car, so it was available with a 360 and all the other larger engine displacements over the year. Just realized it has a bonnet scoop. Is it a good mini alternative? I'm not so sure, but I really like the looks. Check out the steering wheel. It looks very, very sporty. And this is plates from Oldenburg. There are some Civics. Civic is a fantastic looking small Japanese car. Always love the look of that blacked out rear hatch on it. This is quite a rear spoiler. There we have a Honda Aerodeck. Pop-up windows, pop-up headlights. Just have a look at the rear hatch right there. There we have a 626, but not any 626. It's the one with a four-wheel steering. And I think the liftback looks best on this generation 626. There we have a 626 CB, and you might know I do own a CB2 coupe, so this belongs to Laszlo, and this blue 2-liter is part of the family for many years. There's Diane with her 626. It's called Samson, by the way. And then we have another one. Black 626, by the way. This is a 1.6, another 1.6, and then you see the different front end of the 2 liter. Well, I was thinking almost the whole day yesterday, should I bring my Mazda? And I haven't. Okay, there we have a Legacy leaving. It's not leaving. Another Starlet. Let's go and have a look at this Toyota Mark II, and it's a Grande. It is one of the large modern Toyotas we never got, just like the Crown Athlete, all these more premium cars from the Japanese market. There we have a RX-7. I think these are looking good. If I had to choose between RX-7 Mark I and this one, I think I would go with this one. Let's go that way because there is a Toyota Cressida Coupe. Red Cressida Coupe. Again, it's pillarless. There we have the Cressida badge, and said the Cressida was a upmarket Toyota. And on the American market, seriously upmarket, and paved the way for almost everything Lexus. There we have some early Celicas. This is a GTV with a 5-speed. Just have a look at it inside. There is another one. Bonnet's open. And there you can see, I think it's a twin cam. Wasn't it? But it's not the end with early Celicas. There we have some more of them. Just check out the badge. It's so nicely done. old Japanese, the details are amazing. Now some more Celicas. There we have a later Celica generation, and that is a coupe. Not a coupe, sorry. There is the regular Bodystyle, and there we have a 2.0 convertible. There even is a Targa. It's a Targa with a vinyl roof. Haven't seen that version before. If it's still here, I will show it to you in a minute. A Toyota Hilux. And having that said, you remember I was struggling with the Chinook camper thing, and I think it is based on a, is it the early Hilux, is it a Hilux predecessor? Teach me in the comments below, and let's enjoy this awesome Hilux just in this bright red colors. Love the red striping here. Gray steelies. Reminds me on a model car, I guess Majorette. Buzz told me about that some minutes ago, and I think I even had one, but can't remember it right now. There we have a four-door Skyline, Nissan Skyline GT. Check the rear spoiler. These four-door version have a certain appeal to me, because I'm more like a grandpa behind the wheel. And what I like on Japanese saloons are that they often feature a rear wiper. And now we are in Nissan Bluebird territory. And the five-door is my favorite by far. With a sort of vents here at the back. This is a 2.0 SLX, the pop-up roof, spotless interior, but 213,000 kilometers on the odometer. There is another one, and there is another one, all produced in the UK, and now I'm not sure. Let's have a look at this one. Yes, this is a pre-production car from the UK. So the what says the paper right there, it's chassis number 87. It's an SGX, and this is a pre-production car from the UK. Can't remember where it was. Was it Swindon? I'm probably completely wrong, but I think it's a significant car in Nissan history. So Bluebird 2.0 SGX. There we have an SLX. It's just as spotless as the one right over there. It's an automatic. So this is the car for me. There we have a very yellow Laurel that looks a bit like a, not only a bit, it looks very much like a cab. Now, the Toyota Serra, featuring its butterfly doors, and I think it is one of the coolest bubble era cars of all. There we have the Serra badge. Just have a look at this funky interior. I think the McLaren F1 somehow inspired by the Toyota Serra. Also, just have a look at this massive piece of glass here at the back. Unfortunately, without its almost iconic speakers, I may show you a picture now right here. And if not, I haven't one. The Toyota Serra never sold in Europe. It was a Japan market model only. And it's one of the cars I can see myself in. So this is the Sarah. By the way, there we have my Copen. And the Copen did a fantastic job. I spent 4 to 5 hours yesterday in it, and it was just fantastic. It was running without any problems. There we have a big old good old Land Cruiser, a Micra, all the way from France. And here we have, and I am very, very excited, we have some early Hyundai. So Japan Classic Sunday is not only about Japanese cars. These have a place here as well, and I think these should have a place in our classic car world, because these are exciting cars. In many countries, Hyundai started selling these. These were the first Hyundai cars available, and we all know where Hyundai is today. Yeah, let's see what we have here. We have early S Coupe. I love the orange indicators. Just check out the, of course, it's a very gray interior. The S Coupe. Love the look of the rear light cluster. Just check that out. So, what else? We have a Pony LS. These were available as a 3-door and a 5-door. And beside the Pony LS, there's an XL. The XL is the saloon version. In Germany, these were sold, I guess, as a Pony too. So let's have a quick look inside. Someone is sitting in there, so I'm a bit carefully. So there we have a 3-door Pony, the 5-door XL Pony, and then we have the updated S Coupe with a different front end, I'm sure many other details as well. I'm excited to see these cars. I really, really like the Pony because I'm odd. I don't know. This is what I love about the event. And there is a early Hyundai, and you know, two steps away from that, we have a Mitsubishi Sapporo. This exact car was already featured on my Instagram. The Sapporo is one of the very, very few early premium saloons from Japan that actually made it to the market. Always in an exciting spec. This is a manual. I'm afraid you can't see the stereo, and the stereo looks absolutely great. And you know, just like the rear lights on the S Coupe, just check out what's to see here. The beautiful Sapporo badge. It's one of my favorite Japanese saloons. Frameless doors, by the way, and it has a pillarless look. This was a typical style for Japanese saloons, and a set, one of the few of them that actually made it to the market outside of Japan. And I think these are impressive cars. Guess it's a 6-cylinder. Is it a 3.0? I'm not sure. Well, go to Wikipedia by yourself. Okay, there are the Hyundais. Again, let's get to that Cressida saloon. We had the coupe. There we have a 4-door saloon. It says it's next level. Well, the wheels certainly are. It's lowered, so it has a bit of a Buzuzuku touch, and this has a touch on the wheel arches, I guess. So there we have a lovely Cressida. I would prefer an original Cressida, though. Of course, I may be a bit boring. let's go to a car and please forgive me if you own a car like that. I'm seeing one of the worst looking cars ever produced. And that is the, is it a Colt? So, well, it is a fixed roof convertible, just like my Copen. So the badge says, yeah, it's a Colt CZC. So it's a fixed roof convertible. And you know what? It really looks terrible. But please don't let anyone know. I think it is okay with the roof open. Once the roof's up, it's a odd looking thing. Also don't like about these late fixed roof convertibles is that the A-pillar is actually above your head, almost. Brown leather interior. So I said, if you're the owner of this, please forgive me and please enjoy your car. So there we have some MX-6s based on the Ford Probe. Or is the Ford Probe based on that? It is something of the many things I don't know today. So I think I've already shown you the Australian Mitsubishi Magna, Sigma, Galant Coupe, whatever badge it was at the back, because Japanese car manufacturers were quite confusing. And then we have another Australian Japanese car, and that is the Magna. Is it the Magna or the I'm totally wrong, it's a Sigma, of course. I'm a bit confused, but I think Mitsubishi used the Magna badge or Magma badge for a car. So Sigma 3.0. I think exciting car with a sort of swan neck stereo, or is it a sat nav? I don't know, but it's exciting. RX3s are leaving. So is the Mitsubishi. So it feels almost empty now. It was a fantastic day. Weather was fine. Yesterday it was raining cats and dogs almost the whole day. Now having a look at what's left on the table, what I can show you. Lovely early pop-up headlights, MX-5, Supra, Lexus IS 200. These are cars I really, really like. Was it the Toyota Aristo on the Japanese market? I am not sure. Modern Corolla, and there we have some modern Crowns. So we have two Toyota Crown athletes. I'm not trying to name a generation, because that would be definitely wrong, not sure. 180, now I've mentioned it, now I know I'm wrong. AFD Crown badge, the Curry camper van is leaving. Aroma Home, are these made in the UK? I think they are. Here we have a Suzuki Baleno. Daihatsu Kuon, or the Daihatsu Mira, on the Japanese market. There we have some Nissan Sunny Coupes. So a good friend of mine, David, owns one, and he converted his Sunny Coupe to a sort of camper, if you will. There you have it. Four Sunny Coupes. There we have a Nissan Micra March. I think these are brilliant looking small cars. With a rear spoiler, of course. almost empty. Let's have a look at the Stagia leaving the show. There it goes. And then we have a Impreza Fordo leaving the show. Bye bye. See you next year. Rather unfortunately, it's obviously the last time in Chemer, because they have to look for another place. And I hope they find something, because it's such a nice event. Honda NSX behind a Lexus IS200, some MX5s, modern era Colt, the Laurel I've already shown you. I think the most cars here I've already shown. So should we call it a day? Well, I can't stop, because we have to have a look at this very, very old. This is a first gen, I'm not sure, but it is a very, very early Nissan Patrol. These cars paved the way for the success worldwide. Galant leaving, very nice drive home. But it's a Japanese car, nothing will happen. So let's go back to the early Nissan Patrol. Early Patrols, early Land Cruisers, some of them were even produced in other countries. I think it was Nissan or Toyota, they had very early on production of cars in, I think, South America. By the way, Mazda were producing some of their three-wheelers in Greece very early, so they had a foothold on all markets very, very early on. So there we have I think it's a Nissan 200, is it SX? It is SX. There it goes, followed by a right-hand drive Toyota Supra right out of your PlayStation. There it goes. Nissan Baleno, four-door. But when I was looking for my Audi A2, I considered a late Civic, but I haven't. And now my Audi A2 is for 5 weeks at the workshop. There is a Cedric going somewhere. I'm now at some Subaru Vivios belonging to my friends Demi and Matt. There they are. And well, we have a three-door and we have a four-door, three-door and a five-door. Three-door and a five-door. Demi's is on mini lights. On original three mini lights, because, well, one was flat. So one was flat. I do like the Vivio, because I like K cars. Both are featuring hub nut stickers. So Ian, when you see this, there it is. And both parked beside a exciting Daihatsu. That is the Daihatsu, I think, YRV. This is a great looking small car. These were available with the same 1.3 I have in my Copen. So exciting, because I mean, just check the window line. That's amazing. So there we have the Vivios again with the lovely looking Vivio badge. Both are automatic transmission cars. And by the way, Demi's dad owns a Daihatsu Fellow Max. And when I've seen pictures of the Fellow Max on the Japanese Classic Sunday, that was actually one of the reasons to come here. It's not here today, but when I've been to the show for the first time, I had a sit in it. And I enjoyed it very, very much. So yeah, cool pair of cars, cool trio of cars. So I'm now at Marco's Honda Life Step Van. and it is one of a kind. Just have a look at all the details. The interior, it has a 4-stroke 500cc engine. Just see, it has a something for the pen you need, because it's a commercial vehicle. It has a rev counter. This is super, super rare. Marco just told me there are two in Europe. This one here in the Netherlands and one in Finland. Let's close the door and enjoy this car in all its glory. It is absolutely amazing. I love the period alloys. Basically love everything about the car. Marco just told me it does a little bit over 100 kilometers per hour, so it's good for the traffic we have. Let's have a look at all the details. This says I'm slow like a snail. There we have the Japan Automobile Federation badge, blue plates. There's the step van badge. So when we talk about today's show and my favorite cars, it's among my top five. Marco is looking for the indicators. They're usually here. They're now in the front headlights. I think it's almost impossible to source the parts. Well, if you have it by any chance, by any chance, and I guess you're not, leave me a note and I will try to get you to Marco. It's amazing. What do you think about it? It's a proper key van from Japan. I do think the steering wheel is not original. I opened the door again. Marco was so nice to show me around. It even has a wiper control right here. So the wiper switch is right there. And then we have a massive gear stick. I'm not sure if it's a 4-speed. There we have the heater. It's quite roomy. The seats are surprisingly comfy. There, the interior again, of course, with a Honda pen right there. So there we have a Jeco clock. It is working. And what else do we have here? So it says CHG PKB oil. Whatever that means. So this is the interior. It's a quick room tour, if you will, of the absolutely awesome and stunning and unique Honda Life Step Van, one of two in Europe. So the show is almost over, and then there is a Toyota Crown S60, S70 Estate, the Kujira. We've seen the saloon, we've seen the awesome looking coupe, and finally the Estate. And I think it is the first time ever I've seen the Estate, and it looks amazing. Just have a look at this rear light cluster going right there into the rear bumper thing. There we have some sort of air vent at the back. I absolutely love the painted steelies with a bit of a chrome trim on it. That looks the part. Do I have to rearrange the top five of the show? It does look like it. There we have a proper front bench, so there are no front seats. Automatic gearbox. Not sure if it had AC, but that's unlikely. What a fantastic looking car. I absolutely love the color. That suits the car very, very well. I wonder if it's a Dutch car or where it comes from. There we have a crown badge on the C pillar. So finally, a crown estate. Some more details. So there we have double headlights. The indicator on this one is here at the headlights. There we have a crown logo and some sort of air vent thing on the indicator. It's a 2.6. Is it a inline six? I'm not sure. There we have the crown badge. In Japan, the JDM market models were available with rectangular headlights, and these give the car a very, very different look, a very modern look. As far as I know, the S60 Crown had a hard time on the market because, well, it looked very different from anything else. It was maybe a little bit too much of a flamboyant, unusual design, even for the Japanese market. Absolutely stunning. So whoever brought this late to the show, thank you very, very much. Wow.